HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Operation Chastise, the RAF's most brilliant attack of World War II, by Max Hastings. Read by Max Hastings and Peter Noble.
In memory of the air crew who achieved the almost impossible on the night of the 16th to the 17th of May, 1943, and of the men, women, and children on both sides who perished.
There were dams, a dog with an embarrassing name, a movie, a march composed by Eric Coates. These memories of Operation Chastise, the bouncing bomb attack which burst open northwest Germany's Mona and Ada reservoirs on the night of 16-17 May 1943, cling to the consciousness of millions of people of all ages, both sexes, and many nations who may know little else about the Second World War. Wing Commander Guy Gibson's biographer, Richard Morris, has written, "The story of 617 Squadron's breaching of the dams has joined that group of historically based tales like King Arthur or Robin Hood, which defy all efforts at scholarly revision." Much that we think we know is wrong. Those of us who read Paul Brickhill's 1951 book, then watched its 1955 screen progeny, the most popular British war film of all time, should blush to remember that we embraced the dam busters with special enthusiasm because the raid seemed victimless, save for the 53 dead among the gallant young men who carried it out. In truth, however, something approaching 1,400 people, almost all civilians, and more than half French, Polish, Russian, and Ukrainian, mostly female, slaves of Hitler, perished in the Monon catastrophe, as modern Germans call it, more than in any previous RAF attack on the Reich. That tragic outcome deserves emphasis, alongside our awe at 617 Squadron's achievement. It's fascinating that Guy Gibson afterwards reflected uneasily about this, as his superiors never did, writing in 1944, "The fact that people might drown had not occurred to us. But we hoped that the dam wardens would warn those living below in time, even if they were Germans. No one likes mass slaughter, and we did not like being the authors of it. Besides, it brought us in line with Himmler and his boys." This book represents an emotional journey from my own childhood, from the day when, at boarding school, I first thrilled to Richard Todd's portrayal of the 24-year-old Gibson who led 617 Squadron on that fateful night. Many legendary feats of courage have been performed by warriors who clung to some bleeding piece of earth. The 300 at Thermopylae, Horatius on the bridge before Rome, the Guards' defense of Hougoumont at Waterloo, Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain's 20th Maine on Little Round Top at Gettysburg, C Company of the 24th Foot holding Rorke's Drift. By contrast, the deed attempted in May 1943 by 130 British, Canadian, and Australian airmen, together with a single American and two New Zealanders, required qualities of a different order. Almost all were an age with modern gap-year adolescents or students at university. They embarked in cold blood on a mission that many recognised was likely to kill them and that would require exceptional courage, skill and luck to succeed. They lifted their big, clumsy but curiously beautiful bombers from the tranquillity of a summer evening in the midst of the Lincolnshire countryside, barely four decades after the Wright brothers initiated heavier-than-air flight. For 2.5 hours, they raced through the moonlit sky towards Germany at a height that made power cables as deadly a menace as anti-aircraft fire. They then attacked Hitler's dams, flying straight and level at 220 miles an hour, much lower than the treetops and less than a cricket pitch's length from the lakes below, to unleash revolutionary 4.5-ton weapons created by the brilliance and persistence of Barnes Wallace, a largely self-taught engineer. half of 617 Squadron's aircraft, which got as far as Germany, failed to return. But two of the biggest man-made structures in the world collapsed into mud and rubble, releasing hundreds of millions of tons of water upon the Reich. The Allied bomber offensive has become one of the most controversial aspects of the Second World War. Some critics, not all of them German or Japanese, denounce the Western Allied assaults upon cities and their inhabitants as a war crime. The 1945 firebombing campaign by American B-29 superfortresses killed far more people in Tokyo and other Japanese cities than did the atomic bombs later dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The concept of air bombardment of civilians causes many 21st century people discomfort, indeed repugnance. Contrarily, it's a source of bitterness to some descendants of the RAF's wartime bomber crews that the public prefers to lavish legacy adulation on the Spitfire and Hurricane pilots of the Battle of Britain, defenders, than on their comrades, the attackers, who bombed Germany at the cost of enduring losses much greater than those of fighter command. Australian Dave Shannon of 617 Squadron denounced in his old age sanctimonious, hypocritical, and grovelling criticism about things that were done in a total war. Where, in all this, does the saga of the dambusters rightfully belong? The Flyers contrived a feat that caused all the world to wonder. The Allied nations with pride, the German people and their leaders with horror and apprehension. Rumours swept the Reich that 30,000 victims had perished beneath the floods. Though the Lancaster crews were drawn from the RAF's bomber command, the force that nightly rained fire and destruction on Germany's cities, few, even among its critics, failed to perceive a nobility about the bravery displayed that night. In the spring of 1943, after nearly 4 years of austerity, unpalatable food, family separations, and spasmodic terrors, only lately ameliorated by a thin gruel of successes, the British people were weary. The dams raid lifted their spirits, revived flagging confidence in their own nation's powers, as has few events since the desert victory at El Alamein 6 months earlier. We shall discuss below its effects on the Nazi war machine, which RAF planners aspired to cripple. I was born at the end of 1945, and thus was five when Paul Brickhill's best-selling account of Chastise was published. 9. When the film was released. Both book and movie made a profound impression. I memorized the names of almost every one of 617's pilots. I assembled and painted plastic models of the Avro Lancasters that they flew, became intimately familiar with Enemy Coast Ahead, Gibson's posthumously published memoir. As an adult, I began to study wars, first as a correspondent and eyewitness in faraway places, and then as an author of books. Although my ideas became much more nuanced than those of childhood, I was well served by familiarity with a host of World War II memoirs and histories. In 1977, I was commissioned to write Bomber Command, a study of the British strategic offensive. In those days, thousands of former aircrew were still alive, together with some commanders. I interviewed at length Air Chief Marshal Sir Arthur Harris, 1942-45 CNC of Bomber Command, Air Chief Marshal Sir Ralph Cochrane, ex-AOC of 5 Group, to which 617 Squadron belonged, former senior staff officers including Air Vice Marshal Sid Bufton, Director of Bomber Operations at the Air Ministry, Marshal of the RAF, Lord Elworthy, who served as a pilot, station commander, and staff officer at Bomber Command headquarters, together with the inventor of the bouncing bomb, Sir Barnes Wallace, and wartime bombing advisor, Lord Zuckerman. Among former 617 aircrew, I met Group Captain Leonard Cheshire, VC, and Air Vice Marshal Sir Harold Mickey Martin. Many of those above disagreed profoundly with my conclusions, but their testimony was invaluable. The RAF's Battle of Britain flight flew me as a passenger from Farnborough to Coningsby in its only surviving Avro Lancaster, an unforgettable experience. I explored every crew position and occupied the rear turret, albeit with most of my long back sticking out through its sliding doors, while an accompanying Spitfire and Hurricane made passes to give me a gunner's eye view of an attacking fighter. As a war correspondent, I saw more than a few aircraft shot down, and that myself dangled from a parachute, though happily not as a bailed-out airman. In 1994, I spent an airsick afternoon in the rear seat of an RAF Tornado of the latter-day 617 Squadron over Lincolnshire and the North Sea. All these memories have informed my thoughts and stirred my imagination as I wrote this book. Among many previous accounts of Chastise, the 1982 groundbreaker was that of John Sweetman, who performed prodigies of research to transform and much enhance the picture created by Paul Brickhill. I cherish unstinting admiration for Richard Morris, and especially for his 1994 biography of Guy Gibson, which contributed much to Gibson's portrait in my own 2005 book, Warriors. In Germany, Helmut Euler has devoted most of his life to interviewing survivors of the breaching of the dams, as well as assembling images and documentation. I've made a free translation from some of his witnesses' testimony in pursuit of colloquial English. In 2012, James Holland published an exhaustive new account of the raid. Robert Owen, official historian of the 617 Squadron Association, possesses encyclopedic knowledge which he's generous enough to lend to other writers. Rob was a perfect companion on my 2018 visit to the dams, which enabled me to understand on the spot much that was previously obscure about the hazards facing the attackers. Charles Foster has recently published an invaluable new work of reference, The Complete Dam Busters, providing images and details of all 133 aircrew who flew the raid. For my own narrative, I've drawn heavily upon the researches of all the above writers. Richard Morris and Rob Owen especially have saved me from egregious errors. As in all my books, I seek to emphasize the human dimension and the big picture, making no attempt to match the admirable technical detail about Wallace's weapons of which Sweetman and Holland display mastery. An enigma overhangs the personalities of the men of 617 Squadron. Almost all were very young when they attacked the dams, and few survived the war. Records detail what they did. There's much less evidence, however, about what sort of people they were. With the notable exception of Gibson, their stories rely heavily upon adolescent correspondence and anecdotes. They were unformed in almost everything, save having been trained for flight and devastation. Many still thought it the best joke in the world to pull off a man's trousers after dinner. In describing them, an author cannot escape surmise and speculation. Much reported dialogue, especially relating to the hours of action over the dams, relies upon later personal memories, probably more reliable in spirit than wording. On such a matter as, for instance, the sporadic affair between Gibson and WAF nurse Margaret North, historians depend on North's unsupported oral testimony to Richard Morris. Since starting this book, I've been repeatedly asked whether it's an embarrassment to acknowledge the name of Gibson's dog, which became a wireless code word for the breaching of the Mona. Historians' answer must be no more than the fact that our ancestors hanged sheep stealers, executed military deserters, and imprisoned homosexuals. They did and said things differently then. It would be grotesque to omit nigger from a factual narrative merely because the word is rightly repugnant to 21st century ears. I've been moved to retell and to reconsider the Chastise story in hopes of offering a new perspective, which almost represents a paradox. I retain the awe of my childhood for the flyers who breached.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.